Dr. Fauci, first of all, let's just start with this the strain that has now been discovered in Minnesota. I would imagine this doesn't surprise you, but how widespread do you think it could be, given that we're not really testing widely for variants, that it's now shown up?
Well, first of all, if it has the capability of spreading more efficiently, likely it might actually get more and more dominant. But we have to wait and see, because we have a couple of situations. You know, we have a California mutant that was just recognized in California that's different than the Brazil one that seems to be more efficient in spreading. You have to keep your eye on all of these things. And with regard to genomic surveillance, we're really ratcheting that up a fair amount. You're absolutely correct. Up until recently, we haven't had a comprehensive genomic surveillance, which the CDC is really increasing together with a little bit of collaboration, in fact, a lot of collaboration with the NIH, that will get a much better feel for what is circulating in our own country.
Right. And, you know, you mentioned California. I mentioned Brazil. There's South Africa. There's the UK. I only say that in the context of, if there's all that, there's more. And it's obviously able to mutate very quickly. So we don't, you know, there could be many more variants out there. I suppose is the big question for you. How confident are you that one of the ones you know about, or that we don't even know about yet, could change the game here on mortality or vaccine effectiveness?
Well, one of the things you have to do is continue to monitor it. And that's the point, Erin. You have to do that. So if you look at what we know about the UK variant, that the antibodies that are induced by both the Moderna and the Pfizer vaccine seem to be really quite effective in blocking that variant. As I mentioned, the South African and the Brazilian variant are a bit more ominous because some of the monoclonal antibodies, those proteins that we've been using for treatment, several of them are blocked in the sense of the mutant. They do not do very well against the mutant. When you put the vaccine-induced antibodies, it's diminished when you're dealing with South Africa and Brazil. But mostly South Africa. We haven't looked at Brazil as carefully as South Africa. Although it's been diminished somewhat, it's still well within the cushion range of being an effective vaccine. Mm-hmm. So the good news is the vaccines as they exist now still would be effective against the mutants. The sobering news is what I think you were alluding to, that as you get more and more replication, you can get more and more evolution of mutants, which means you've always got to be a step ahead of it, which is the reason why two things need to be done. One, you've got to increase your surveillance, and you've got to have the flexibility. The way we're doing with the South African isolate is essentially making a version of the current vaccines by allowing us to perhaps give a boost sometime in the future, months from now, to be able to cover those mutants. So you got to always stay a step ahead of the game. Because the virus continues to mutate. One more comment that I think people need to understand. Mm-hmm. The best way you prevent the evolution of mutants is to suppress the amount of virus that's circulating in the population. And the best way to do that is to get as many people vaccinated as quickly as you possibly can.
So let me ask you, you know, you've spoken out now, I know, Dr. Fauci, about some of your frustrations about President Trump, you know, receiving information that you say was based on no data. You know, we all remember, you know, infamously when people said, where are you getting your numbers? And he said, here, you know, here in my head, and gestured his head. You know, I remember talking to Dr. Scott Atlas on this show, and he was talking about how, you know, no issue with people not wearing masks at crowded rallies. Obviously, he had promoted the controversial idea of herd immunity to the president, and herd immunity not via a vaccine, right, via transmission. Then there was the doctor with the false claims about hydroxychloroquine, the MyPillow founder talking about an unproven plant extract as a cure for coronavirus. The president also talked about that. How bad was the misinformation that was being given to the president regularly?
Well, you know, there was a combination of good information and bad information. Unfortunately, the concept of anecdotal as opposed to science-driven information seemed to prevail above that. I mean, I think if you look at the pushback that I got from people in the White House, including the president, about hydroxychloroquine was one of the reasons why I felt it was essential for me to, not in a confrontative way, I took no great pleasure out of contradicting the president, but I had to get up just to maintain my own integrity, but also to be standing up for science that the data did not show what they were claiming. I mean, anecdotes are okay to give you the spurring on to take a look at a scientific approach, yep, but to be ruled by anecdote is folly.
Right, and that obviously is what happened. I mean, we heard it, right? There was the ingesting bleach. I mean, there's no anecdote on that. Obviously, that one was just...
Right.
That one was just beyond the pale. I mean, can I just ask you, when he said that, I mean, Dr. Birx obviously had the unfortunate... she was unfortunately there. What went through your mind when he said that?
I just said, oh, my goodness gracious, I could just see what's going to happen. You're going to have people who hear that from the president and are going to start doing dangerous and foolish things, which is the reason why immediately those of us who were not there said, this is something you should not do. Be very explicit. The CDC came out, I think, the next day,
yeah,
and put in one of their publications, do not do this. I got asked on a number of shows, certainly on CNN, and I said, absolutely, this is not what you want to do.
So you came out and said that, and as you point out, you took no pleasure in contradicting the president, but you had to do it multiple times. And as a result, Dr. Fauci, you got disturbing threats. You've talked about some of them, and threats against your wife, your children. You got that envelope with white powder, and you feared that could have been something deadly, anthrax, ricin. All of this coming because you came out and were disagreeing with the president. I mean, when you saw what happened on January 6th, the insurrection, right, the people who believed every single word that he said, and they were there echoing that, did it seem inevitable to you because you had firsthand experience the threats of violence?
Yeah. Well, it did. In fact, what it did to me is to just underscore the intensity of the divisiveness in our society, because if merely articulating a commonly held public health message of something that every public health official in the country would agree with, because I articulate that publicly, if that triggers death threats against me, harassment of my family, my children and my wife, somebody sending me an envelope with powder that explodes in my face to scare me and my family, boy, that tells you the depth of the divisiveness. And then January 6th, to me, was like, oh, my goodness, here it is in its ultimate. It's purely a reflection of divisiveness that is so deep that it's disturbing. And to me, you know, as a person who, you know, I don't want to seem melodramatic, who loves our country, I just see that being nothing but destructive, and it's very scary.
I mean, you get an envelope and it explodes in your face. I mean, at that moment, what do you think?
Well, you know, it's very interesting, Erin, is that this is the life I've chosen, and this is what I do, and this is my job. You know, I'm not a hero at all, by any means, but I was very fatalistic about it. You know, as I said in the interview with the New York Times, I said, oh, my goodness, it's either a hoax or it's anthrax and I have to take ciprofloxacin for 1 or 2 months, or it's ricin and I'm dead. You know, there's nothing. But then once I got past that, I realized what a terrible effect it would have on my children, because until the examination came back and we found out that it was harmless powder, my children were very, very distraught by that. And that's more painful to me than somebody, some jerk, threatening my life. I mean, that's just the way it is with me. I just don't want to see my family get involved. I mean, I chose this life and this is what I do. They did not choose that. They did not choose that life.